Electricity manifests in a refrigerator as coldness, in a heater as warmth, and in a bulb as light. A television will not have the same qualities as a light bulb, nor a light bulb that of a television. Nor will a refrigerator be able to do what the heater does, and vice versa. However, the electric current that flows through all these appliances is one and the same. Likewise, although there may be external differences between women and men, the indwelling consciousness is one. Everything has its place in the universe. Nothing is insignificant. There is a significance and consciousness behind each expression of creation. Everything has its own essential nature. Some things may be big, others small. Light is the nature of the sun, waves the nature of the sea, and coolness the nature of wind. What endows a deer with placidity and a lion with cruelty is its own original nature. Similarly, women and men have their own unique natures that distinguish them from each other. They should remember their innate nature that constitutes the very fiber of their existence. In their attempt to defeat men, some women now smoke and drink like them, forgetting their gift of motherhood. Doing so is not only dangerous, it simply will not bring about the sought-after changes. Man is not better than woman, nor is woman better than man. The fundamental truth is that in creation, no one is superior to anyone else. Attributing supremacy to God alone, women and men can become instruments in the service of the Almighty. It is from this approach that true equality between them can emerge. What we are seeing today is a clash between past and future. The male community that stands unwilling to compromise is the emblem of the past. If the future is to be a beautiful, fragrant, fully blossomed flower, women and men must join hands in all spheres. Those who desire peace and contentment in the world community must pay heed to this right now, in this very moment. For the sake of a promising future, the minds and intellects of women and men need to become one. We cannot wait any longer. The more we delay, the worse the state of affairs in the world will become. If women and men unite, they can establish healthy governance. But in order for this shift to come about, there needs to be mutual understanding and open-hearted dialogue. Snake venom can cause death, but it can also be converted into medicine capable of saving someone's life. Likewise, we can convert our negative thoughts into abilities. We can still save society. Only love can transform the venom of negative thoughts into ambrosia. Love is an emotion common to all living beings. It is the path women can take to reach men, men to women, both to nature and nature to the universe. And the love that overflows all boundaries is universal motherhood. The greatest flowering that can take place on this earth is that of the flower of love. A beautiful flower with color and fragrance blossoms naturally, even from a small plant. In a similar way, love sprouts in human hearts, then blossoms and expands. Both women and men should permit this flowering from within. There is nothing more profound than the strength and beauty of two hearts that love each other. Love has the mind-cooling freshness of the full moon and the scintillating brilliance of the sun's rays. But love will not enter our hearts without permission. Women and men should be equally willing to invite within this love that is waiting. Only love can bring about a permanent change in the mindsets and, therefore, the realities of women and men. If the wife and husband live in mutual understanding, the increasing sense of alienation between them will decrease. In this way, the problems in society will also be reduced to a certain extent. Today, a wife and husband may even proclaim, just to delude others, "We are living together in mutual love and faith." This is make-believe love. Love is not something to be imagined or faked, but lived. It is life itself. Pretending is like wearing a mask. No matter who dons it, it must be removed. Otherwise, time will remove it. Depending on the duration of the character's role, some will remove it earlier, whereas others may have it removed from them a little later. This is the only difference. How did love, which is the intrinsic nature and obligation of a human being, become a mask? It is when one denigrates oneself by acting without humility or compromise that love becomes a pretense. For example, if you just stand by a clear river and look, will your thirst be quenched? In order to quench one's thirst, one must bend down to drink the water. Instead of doing this, if one remains standing upright and curses the river, what is the point? It is just as easy to fill ourselves with the crystalline waters of love if we surrender. Women and men in relationships today have become like secret police. Whatever they see or hear makes them suspicious. Such doubt robs them of longevity and health, and is indeed a serious disease. People afflicted with this disease lose their capacity to listen empathetically to the problems of each other. Even though many relationships are suffering, we have not lost love forever. If love dies, the universe would die. The undying ember of love is in everyone. We simply need to blow on it and it will be fanned into flames. We are seeing more and more species of animals becoming extinct. Are we going to allow love to become extinct in the human heart in the same way? To prevent this extinction of love itself, human beings must return to respecting, worshipping, and reposing their faith in a divine power. That power is not outside, but in order to discover it inside, we need to adjust our perspective. For example, while reading a book, what we focus on are only the words, not the paper on which the words have been neatly printed. The paper is the substratum on which the words have been made clear. Try this experiment with a few people. Cover a fairly big board with white paper. Make a small black mark in the center of the white paper. Then ask those present, "What do you see?" Most people will probably say, "I see a small black dot." Very few will say, "I see a black mark in the center of a large piece of white paper." Humanity today is like this. We must first recognize that love is the very nucleus of life. When we read, we must certainly be able to see the letters. However, when reading, we must also acknowledge the paper that is the substratum. Today, instead of looking outward from the inside, we are trying to look inward from the outside. In this way, we will not be able to see anything clearly. In worldly life, women and men have their own needs and rights while vying to gain money, position, prestige, and freedom. Striving hard to gain all these, they are expending so much time and effort. Amidst all this exertion, we should set aside a corner of our mind to remember one truth. Without love, we will not be able to derive happiness or satisfaction from any name, fame, position, or money. Our mind, intellect, and body need to be resolutely fixed on pure love, which is the center point of life. It is vital to work from this center of pure love. Then the differences between women and men will only manifest in the realm of form, and we will realize that, in essence, we are one. Jaipur is an ideal place for this conference. The earth here has borne witness to a noble culture. Princesses of uncommon valor and unworldly purity were born and lived here. Through their pure minds and powerful sacrifices, they upheld invaluable ideals in life. Courage and mental purity are qualities a woman needs, regardless of time or place. If these qualities become her very life breath, society will place her on a pedestal, and the position, name, fame, and adoration she deserves will reach her spontaneously. Actually, mental purity is the basis of courage, and the source of mental purity is love. Only love can liberate women and men from the dark prisons of the past and usher them into the light of truth. Love and freedom are interdependent. Love can only dawn in a heart that has been freed from thoughts of the past. Only when there is love within will the mind become free. When the mind becomes free, one attains complete freedom in life. If we want to gain freedom, equality, and happiness, human beings must either love one another or love nature, or else they must strive to realize their inner self. The time for doing any one of these is long overdue. Further delay at this point spells grave danger for humanity. Many women come to Amma crying and ask, "Why did God have to make us women?" When Amma asks them why they should ask such a thing, they say, "Men are harassing us physically and mentally. When they speak, it is full of condescension. Because of this, we are beginning to feel disgusted with ourselves." They feel that to be born a woman is a curse, and that to be born a man is superior in every way.